Hello, Sabina Brennan here, host of Superbrain, the podcast for everyone with a brain. It takes just 30 seconds on Google or Apple Pay to make a one-off donation to support this show. Simply follow the Support This Show link in the show or episode description. Cheers. Hello and welcome to Superbrain, the podcast for everyone with a brain. My name is Sabina Brennan and I want to start this episode by thanking my guest, journalist, novelist and agony aunt, Hilary Freeman, for bravely agreeing to chat with me over two episodes about some seriously painful moments from her past. In this week's episode, we talk about her experience of public global online shaming. And next week, we talk about her resilience and how she coped with the death of her daughter under very painful circumstances. Hilary has experienced enough of the nasty side of social media to last a lifetime. As we chat, she and I try to understand how social media went from a wonderful, sharing, caring community to an online mob. Please listen with humanity and be kind.
We met in Bucharest at a conference on multiple sclerosis. That's I was speaking at the conference and you were covering it for a newspaper. And during one of the breaks, we were chatting and we were talking actually about the Daily Mail. And I was saying that how fortunate I felt when I discovered that the Daily Mail were going to feature extracts from my book. I was really, really excited because I thought this is exactly the kind of audience I want to reach. I really want to give people the brain health message, very general audience. And having done interviews, etc., before, I was very keen to see, you know, that the science wasn't misrepresented or the book. Anyway, so basically they sent me my article to read and I went through it and it was actually really fine. I was really, really pleased with it. I was really excited for it to come out because they were going to be including a link to selling the book and I thought, oh, this is great. And the next thing, anyway, I get to see it and the cover of it says, sorry, the headline said, started off grand, the tiny tweaks that age-proof your brain from changing radio stations to avoiding tubby friends. Oh. a neuroscientist reveals the small life changes that can create new brain matter. Of course, then I made the mistake of going down and reading the comments. And
and that's all they'd read.
They actually hadn't read. And actually, there was there was a couple of people who actually took the time to say, well, actually, if you read the article, that's not what she said. What I actually was talking about was how it's important for your brain health to maintain a healthy weight, to quit smoking, you know, avoid alcohol. And then I actually had said in the article, and I say it in my book and I stand over it, be aware of social contagion, whereby if you are with friends who are likely to take risks or overeat or drink alcohol to excess, you are more likely to also engage in that behaviour.
Of course. It's like if you're out for dinner and everyone says, oh, let's have a dessert, you're more likely to have a dessert.
Absolutely.
You? You might not do otherwise.
No, absolutely. And that's simply what I was said. But avoiding tubby friends, I mean, that's dreadful. And I was very fortunate because it was only comments to a Daily Mail article.
Yeah.
And most of them hadn't even bothered to check me out anywhere because a lot of them were referring to me as a he. So they hadn't even bothered to
notice. Because you're a doctor, therefore you must be a he.
Because I was a doctor, I must be a he.
Oh dear.
You know? So this is kind of what I shared that story with you in Bucharest. And then you shared a much, much worse experience. But as it happened, it was also around obesity.
And the Daily Mail. Yes.
Yeah, so would you like to tell us? Tell us a little more.
I wrote an article, an opinion piece about how I didn't think that telling people that were obese that they look great was necessarily a very good thing. The body positivity movement might be counterproductive in the sense that it's encouraging people to be overweight. And instead of saying you look great, we should be talking about health, not about looks. So it was it was a slightly controversial article anyway, but I made the mistake of using an illustration in the introduction of a woman who I'd met at a nursery that I was looking at for my daughter when she was two, who was extremely morbidly obese and could barely walk. And I just made the point that you know, that it shouldn't be normalised that there was more than one very obese person at this nursery, and also that the food that they were eating wasn't healthy food at the nursery. But what happened was that the headline became nothing. None of my reasoned argument about health, which is basically what the article was, lots of things about health and medicine and obesity. It was why I will never let my daughter be taught by a fat teacher, I think it was.
I actually have it here, yeah. Oh God, yeah. Why I refuse to let my daughter be taught by a fat teacher. Writer Hilary Freeman says it's time for some home truths about obesity.
Yes, and that is not what the article argues at all. She wasn't a teacher. She was a nursery assistant. I have no problem with anybody of any shape, size, gender, race, whatever, teaching my daughter. I just worry about my daughter eating jam sandwiches for tea and being in the care of someone who can't walk and breathe properly, which I think is fairly.
Yeah, and I mean, the thing is, you know, actually it was interesting in some of the comments. I kind of read over them again before we doing this interview. In some of the comments to my own, actually one of the women said, look, my husband is morbidly obese. Mm. I'm overweight. We have children. I would really like for them not to become obese. I want my children to be healthy. But she said, no matter what I do, my husband keeps bringing in, you know, biscuits and sweets, and he shows his love by giving those to his children. And she pointed out, children learn by example. So I really fear for my kids. And I think that was the point, in a sense, that you were making. The point that I was making is that midlife obesity increases your risk of developing dementia.
Yeah.
And, you know, the funny thing in comments that I got was, well, you know what, you know, my family and friends are all obese and I'd rather have dementia than lose my family and friends. And that's not the argument or the point at all. It's really around, I think it's very specific, and I wonder if you agree, to social media and to online, whereby we almost have moral masses kind of coming out and saying, you know, we need to protect people who are heavy, or we need to protect, you know, people of whatever minority group. Yeah. And in that's absolutely fine. And I would absolutely imagine that you're of that same viewpoint.
Oh, of course. I think the thing is, on social media, people see everything in black and white. It's either you're being nice or you're being mean. It's good or it's bad. There's no nuance at all. And especially when people only read headlines and don't actually read the argument in a you know, 2,000 word feature, and of course, you know, I don't believe in discriminating against people who are overweight. I don't believe in fat shaming people, and that's what I was accused of, was fat shaming. But I also think that telling everybody that it doesn't matter how unhealthy they are, they're still great, is just going to make more people feel that it's okay to be overweight, and then that's going to make more people sick.
And we do have increasing numbers of the population who are, you know, becoming overweight. But that, you know, the actual content, that it just so happened that we were both speaking about obesity, and people online felt that, you know, it was their moral duty to call you out and shame you about it, etc. Yeah. I mean, actually, that would be interesting if you go on to explain what happened after the article went out. If it's not too painful.
No, it's all in the past now. I can deal with it. So I had a response I had no idea that was coming at all. I knew the article might be a little bit controversial, but I had written about obesity in the past, probably in sort of pre-social media days when at the very beginning of it, when it wasn't so big. And I expected a few comments from people not appreciating some of the messages in the article. What I got was the most enormous backlash, mainly from America, actually, where obviously people are a lot bigger and there is much, the body positivity movement is a very big thing. And they were just attacking me, calling me a fat shamer, a lot of them started to get very personal about me, saying, well, you're not skinny, so why should, you know, why should we listen to you? And obviously I hadn't read the article, because part of what the article said was, I'm not somebody who's naturally skinny. I have to work at staying slim and fit, and, you know, I have an underactive thyroid. So actually, you know, the excuse that people use that they have an underactive thyroid, you know, I understand that, and, you know, but people just don't read that stuff. And and I was told, you know, either people, there was complete contradiction of things that people were saying. So some of them were attacking me for not being overweight, therefore I'm not allowed to talk about this issue because I don't understand. Some of them were saying, well, you're not so slim anyway, so how dare you tell us about being, you know, we need to be slim. Some of them were really, really, really nasty and vicious. And actually I had things, some death threats, you know, not death threats from anyone that I took seriously enough to report to the police, because they were from people, and mainly from people in America, as I said, and they didn't know where I lived or anything, but it's still very upsetting and shocking. I had the worst messages I got were on Facebook. People messaged me saying things like, one woman said, you're an unfit mother, and I hope that your daughter gets cancer and dies horribly and painfully and slowly. I lost a child a few years ago, and I'd put a memorial thing on the anniversary of her death on my Facebook page, and that was on a public, it was my photograph, so it was public, and someone had obviously trawled through my photographs, and they said something like, you're an unfit mother, you deserved for your daughter to die, and she's better off, stuff like that. So really nasty, horrific personal
things. That's even
things.
Worse actually than I thought. Yeah. That's really just horrific.
Oh, horrible, horrible stuff. But it was, in a way, that stuff is so shocking that it's not even upsetting, because you just realise that these people are horrible, horrible trolls.
But was it upsetting at the time?
Yes, time. It was definitely upsetting at the time. I mean, the way that I dealt with it was to talk about it, and to post the messages on my Facebook to my friends,
okay,
saying, look at this, look what this person's, you know, done, can you believe this? And then of course you get lots of support from people, and some people were very helpful in saying, you know, I'm going to track them down and I'm going to contact their employer and send them the screenshot of what they've said to you, because this, you know, people should know about what this person is like. So I did feel supported in that way. But the other part of the backlash of writing that article was that I did actually lose some friends who were not happy about the article. And that was actually harder to deal with, the real life implications of it.
This is interesting. I mean, I'm kind of interested in the whole phenomenon of it, you know, that how people can be so brutal.
Yes.
Online, and for me as well, that seems, I hadn't realized that you had lost personal friends through it, because you can kind of somehow, you know, make it, well, that's them, and these are, you know, people that I don't know or don't have meaning to me, but for it to kind of move into your personal life, and then also it moved into your employment.
Yes. So the editor of a publication that I had a column in, as an agony column, sent me a message the day that the article came out saying, we're terminating your contract. We can no longer employ you as our agony aunt. We don't like what you said. You know, my opinion wasn't being nasty. My opinion was trying to
start a conversation.
Yeah, start a conversation. Say, look, we're all talking about it's great to be big. We're talking about, you know, let's put over, you know, plus size models on magazines, and then at the same time we're saying people that the obesity rate is massively growing. diabetes is a huge problem. It's costing the NHS millions and millions of pounds. We can't sustain that. People are getting sick. Children are going to be dying younger than their parents' generation. We've got to do something about this. So maybe these two messages are conflicting, and let's try and talk
but
about
they're,
it.
They're not mutually exclusive either. That's the thing. So I think that's what happens, is it becomes very black and white. You're with us or you're against us, yeah, sort of mentality, which is confrontational to begin with.
Yeah.
But when it comes to, you can be inclusive, you can support people who are overweight, you can love people who are overweight. Yeah. But on the same token, you can kind of also go, well, look, this is going to be detrimental to your health. What can we do about it? They really are not, you know, mutually exclusive. But
exactly,
it appears to be that people see anything, saying anything negative about somebody who is overweight in regards to their health,
yeah,
as being, you know, fat shaming. That takes me on in a way to the whole shaming thing, which I don't know if you've read John Ronson's book, So You've Been Publicly Shamed.
I've read some of it, yes.
Yeah, so he tackles the whole area of public shaming, and people listening may remember Justine Sacco. She had written a very clumsy tweet before she was heading on a flight to South Africa, and it was around she was heading off to Africa.
She was the PR woman.
She worked in PR, and she just put a tweet saying, you know, heading off to Africa, hope I don't get AIDS, oh I'm white, I won't, right? So anyway, she got on her very, very long flight. She fell asleep on the flight.
Yeah.
While she's asleep, one of her, and I think she only had like 127 followers on Twitter. She wasn't anybody big or anything like that. But one of her followers shared it with one of these gawker reporters who had 15,000 followers, and then he shared it and suddenly it exploded.
Yeah.
And the whole of the internet were shaming her, calling her a racist, etc. Now, she was on a very long flight to South Africa, so it actually built and built. And this happened with this girl who was on the flight because she was unaware. Mm. You know, her world had exploded, and people were counting down to when she was going to land to watch her reaction online. And there was even people saying, surely there's somebody there. What flight is she on? You know, let's go and see. And then, you know, people tweeting, yes, I'm here. I have my camera at the ready,
yes,
you know. And this girl, long story short, she made a very clumsy tweet. She was actually trying to make a self-depreciating joke about Americans living in a bubble and not realizing, you know, the extent of, you know, the AIDS epidemic. And but it was very clumsy, and it was easily interpreted as racist.
And again, there's no nuance on social media.
There was no nuance on social media. She couldn't step in and defend herself. She couldn't delete the tweet before, you know,
I'm
it got anywhere.
Cringing remembering it. Yeah.
Yeah, it really was quite horrific. And actually, you know, where people did try to step in and go, hold on a second, you could read that this way, they were then vilified.
But what I found interesting as well, in my experience, what happened to me, and also I think happens to a lot of other people, is that after my article came out, other people started writing articles about my article, and they would take the headline and they would take a summary of what they thought it said, and then they would write it. And that spread all around, mainly around America, around the world. And so what was then people were reading and commenting on and sending me messages about was not my article at all, but somebody else's perception of my article, or somebody else's criticism of my article. And then the social media started becoming about that, not about what I'd said, but about what other people had said about me. And so people lose actually the truth, and it grows and grows and grows.
And I think that's the interesting thing, and I didn't really realise until I started writing articles. I'm not a professional journalist, you know, but writing pieces and commenting to pieces, is that you as a writer, you as a journalist, me as someone writing about, you know, brain health or these things, have absolutely no control over what the headline of your article is.
No.
It's not written by you.
No. It's written by a sub. Sometimes, very occasionally, you can ask to have headline approval. It's very unusual to get it. But yes, yes. So people aren't aware. Yeah.
And the general public aren't aware. And I'd love it. I almost think that there should be a, you know, subheading written by.
Yes.
Article written by. Yes. Because, I mean, it's broken my heart several times, and not just in that instance. And sometimes I've even found things like, I would be passionate about not referring to older people as the elderly. I don't see it as any different than referring to the blacks or the gays. You know, it's kind of othering. Yeah. And I've written articles that actually may be about that topic.
Yes.
And then there'll be the elderly in the title. And I kind of go, how can I stand over that?
I've had exactly the same with MS. People with multiple sclerosis don't like to be called sufferers.
Yes.
You know, I personally don't have a problem with someone calls me a sufferer, because obviously, you know, it's not something I enjoy having particularly. But, you know, generally people don't want to be called sufferers. They don't want to be seen as victims. So we, you know, that's not what we say. We say people with MS or MSs. And the number of times I've been so careful to not put sufferer anywhere in the article, or to make sure, to even tell my editor, please don't put sufferer. And then the headliner said MS sufferers. Yes. So it's just wrecked.
But taking us back to the whole kind of phenomena of it, there's something interesting, and you touched on it there, that you know, the internet and social media gave the voiceless a voice.
Yes.
And again, John Ronson talks about this in his book, and he said it was so exciting because for the first time in our lives, you know, Joe Bloggs, the general public, all of us could have a voice, and we could have an opinion, and we could share it. And initially it started in a wonderful way that allowed people to talk about their flaws and find that, as is the case with anything, you know, if you're experiencing it, you can guarantee that thousands of others are experiencing it, or they feel that way, or they feel down, or they feel this. And it became this lovely space for a sharing and a connecting.
Yeah.
And then somehow this virtual community built up that now has actually become a mob.
Yes.
A shaming mob.
It's something I've always been very wary of and scared of. I don't like big groups. I don't like crowds. I don't like movements where, even when I was a kid, when you all had to sort of join in and sing the same thing and, you know, sort of go, yay. And I never felt comfortable doing that. And I don't know if it's because I was brought up, you know, as a Jewish child, the granddaughter of Holocaust survivors, but this kind of whole mob mentality terrifies me. It's the ordinary nobodies who become the torturers and the people who allow these regimes to flourish. It's not the people at the top that make it work. It's the people who either turn a blind eye or just go along with it.
But that's in a way part of the human condition, and
yes.
I think we have to acknowledge that.
Yeah.
You know, we all think we're good people, and we all believe that we're not capable of doing terrible things. But what's happening on social media actually is an example of how awful we can be.
Yes.
Because it's not just trolls. Yes, we have trolls do certain things, but it is not just trolls who say the certain things. Like, it wasn't trolls who wrote about you. It was ordinary everyday people, including your friends and other journalists. It wasn't just trolls against, you know, Justine Sacco. It was thousands and thousands of people. In fact, actually, I think something like prior to that tweet, her name was searched 40 times a month on the internet.
Mm.
I think the tweet happened on the 20th of December. And between the 20th of December and the end of December, her name had been searched 1.5 million times or 1.2 million times.
Yeah.
So that's a lot of ordinary, everyday people. When we become part of a group, some people, and a lot of people, can lose touch with their own moral compass.
Yes.
And they get swept along with whatever's happening in the group. And part of that is probably feeding in also to those reward systems, because you're part of a group.
Yes.
And, you know, everybody's doing this and everybody's together.
And people are liking your tweets or your Facebook comments, and they're sharing them, and therefore you're getting
reward. You're getting dopamine release.
Yeah, you're being endorsed.
In your brain, you're being endorsed. So that's the whole reason social media works.
Of course.
They really understand the human brain. It's part of the reason I'm passionate about trying to explain explain to people how your brain works, because I think it's empowering. Because so many people who have a big role in your life, such as the people who have set up social media, boy, do they really understand how your brain works. They really understand how your reward system works. And that's it. That's how simple it is. Simply getting a like or a little beep or a little click on your phone. You know, even if you're playing a game, it's the beeps and the clicks are great. You know, you get a little buzz and a reward. But the problem with reward is it can become, you know, like that, it can become addictive, and you want more and you want more and you want more. And it all feeds into this cycle.
And I wonder if it's actually making people nastier, because I was brought up, if you don't have anything nice to say, don't say it.
Yes.
You know? So, you know, we've all like seen someone walking down the road and thought, oh God, you know, she looks awful, what's she wearing? But you just wouldn't say it. Mm-hmm. But on social media, you say it. And then, well, I don't say it, but some people say it, and then everybody will like it, and then other people will share it, and it's like, oh, well, it's okay to say that, and suddenly it becomes okay to be nasty. So I wonder if it's actually making people feel it's okay.
So I'm really interested, actually, as well, as in how social media is changing our brains and changing how we interact as a species. So when we're being socially engaged with people, being part of a social group, is quite complicated behavior, but there's a lot of rules around being socially engaged.
Yes.
And there's social norms, and sometimes they're related to culture and sometimes they're not. And if you break those social norms in face-to-face society, generally speaking, you're ostracized. And that either can be from a group that you're a part of, you know, whether it's a football team or, you know, or, you know, a wider society in general. If you break the rules, there will be a punishment, a payoff of sorts. Now, we developed an internet and a social media because we could.
Yeah.
And there's been no ethical considerations of the unintended consequences of developing such a media. In a way, it's a little bit similar to the, you know, splitting the atom, and the scientists not thinking that ever that an atom bomb would be created from it.
Yeah.
And so we've got this amazing resource. I'm not against the internet. I'm not against social media. But one of these unintended consequences is that it's changing social behavior online, and I think that's very, very scary. And the other thing about this group behavior is that when we are in a group engaging in an activity, there's also a sense of diminished culpability. It's like you're only one piece of the bad thing, so that's not really that bad.
Yes, exactly. And also, you know, you've said it, they've said it, so actually it must be what everyone thinks, so therefore it's not that bad.
And that's forgetting the bubble as well, where you're just fed back in social media the people who agree with you. And and so it's actually, it's called, you know, sort of social media, and in some ways it gets us connected, but actually in other ways it's made us much more disconnected from diverse views.
Yes. And the way I've noticed, it's totally changed my relationships as well, in the sense that there's a kind of group of people on social media, and because I work from home, I tend to be on social media a lot, because it's my water cooler, it's my, you know, my office. I don't have anyone else to talk to when I'm working from home, so I'm on there a lot, and there's the same crowd of people who are responding and interacting with me. And sometimes I step back and I think, I've never met some of these people. Mm-hmm. I know nothing really about their lives, because sometimes they'll post something and I'll be like, God, I didn't know that about them. And I realize that I'm talking to people I don't really know all day. And yet my close friends who aren't on social media, I maybe speak to every few weeks.
Thank you for listening. Hilary and I will continue our chat next week. For regular updates and bonus material, follow Superbrain Podcast and Sabina Brennan on Instagram and at Sabina_Brennan on Twitter. Subscribe to Superbrain on Acast, Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. And remember, if you loved it, rate it, review it, and share it.